So, are you curious enough to know what Elon Musk's first wife describes Elon Musk and their relationship? And how do you think she would describe her relationship? That's what you wouldn't want to miss, so stay tuned in this video. Welcome to Elon Musk Era. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to our channel to stay updated on our upcoming videos about Elon Musk, Tesla, SpaceX, and more. According to Justine Musk, in the spring of 2008, Elon Musk, her wealthy entrepreneurial husband, the father of her five young sons, filed for divorce. Then, a few weeks later, he texted her to tell her he was engaged to a beautiful British actress in her early 20s who had moved to Los Angeles to be with him. It was Tallulah Riley, who played one of the sisters in Pride and Prejudice in 2005. And the first thing that struck her was that Pride and Prejudice is a really good film. Her life with this man had become cliché. But she found it refreshing that she was not blonde. Also, when she met Elon for the first time, she wasn't blonde either. At the time, she was a first-year student at Queen's University in Ontario, Canada, fresh from her small hometown and recovering from a difficult relationship with the older man she left behind. The reason for this is because she preferred older. She preferred poetic and rebellious. She preferred tortured. So, what else does Justine Musk have to say about Elon Musk and their relationship? We will give you the information she shared in a talk, so make sure you subscribe to the channel. You know, for Justine Musk, her ex-husband, or as she sometimes likes to think of him, her baby daddy, is the visionary of Elon Musk of Tesla and SpaceX. She met him when she was 18, he was 19, and they were at college. He would call her up, he always had classical music playing in the background, and he would ask her out, and she would say no. And he would call her up again, and he would ask her out, and she would say no. And it went on like this, until they ended up living together in an apartment in the Bay Area, which they shared with three roommates, and a miniature dachshund who was not house-trained. Then, by the time they were divorced, they were living in a house in Bel Air with no roommates and a miniature dachshund who was still not house-trained. And for Justine, it's a funny Simpsons episode. She even describes it as Elon having this meaningful relationship with Homer. It's very romantic, and at one point, the Smithers character says to another character that somebody like Elon must have darkness in his soul. And as a dark fantasy writer who's had novels published by major publishers and stories and anthologies and has a blog, this line leapt out at Justine because she thinks a lot about creativity and darkness and the larger-than-life nature of these people that we call visionaries and geniuses, or as their son likes to say, genii. So, she further added that darkness does not have to mean evil, because for her, it can refer to anything that has not yet been brought out into the light, that lives in the space beyond boundaries, beyond our comfort zone, where a lot of us don't want to go. She even shared a quote from the writer, Lucy H. Pierce, that she liked a lot, which says, "As creatives, our job is to uncover what lies in the darkness and give it new life, new identity." Then she realizes that artists and entrepreneurs are a lot alike in that they are both obsessed with writing and creating something out of nothing with pulling value from the dark. So, when she was preparing this talk, she said to Elon, if the latter has any advice that Justine could maybe give to bright young things in the audience who might want to like growing up to be him one day. And he did say something, which she'll get to at the end, but he also said, according to her, that he doesn't know if they would still want that if they knew what it's like to be him. And it made Justine think that before we call these people visionaries, before they have that kind of success, we have other words for them. We call them geek or outsider, socially awkward, weird, a little different, odd one out. So, she even shared to have been friends with one person for 10 years before Elon told her that when he was a kid, he hated going to school because the other kids liked to follow him home and they would throw soda cans at him. So he sought refuge in computer games, which got him into coding, which led to the creation of his first company, which he sold by the time he was in his mid-20s. So you know nobody's throwing cans at him now. Furthermore, during her years with Elon, she became familiar with a distinct and deeply tribal mentality known as engineers. And once her dad came to visit, he was taking him to see Elon at Zip2, which is Elon's first company, and they were crossing through the office park and they saw these lanky dudes in jeans and a t-shirt. Then, they were racing these remote-controlled contraptions around the parking lot and banging them into cars, and her dad would ask if these are the children of the engineers. And she replied, no, and added that these are the engineers. And when Elon and her would travel, they had to fill out all those forums and customs that wanted to know about their occupation. Elon never wrote down CEO or King of the World or Studly International Playboy. Do you know what Justine shared about what Elon wrote? So he wrote engineer, and he wore jeans and t-shirts to work. And whenever they went shopping for clothes or later consulted with a stylist, whose name was Martin, he would say to Justine, no, you don't understand. I can't look cool or hip because I have to look like an engineer. And one of the things that Elon told her, although she doesn't know if it's true now as it was back then, was that engineers could not quite figure out why it was that suits made the big money when it was the engineers who built the stuff that they were selling. And meanwhile, the suits would listen to the engineers talk and they would have no idea what they were saying. And that's when she realized that Elon was somebody who had learned to speak both languages. And he could move between the tribes because he was an engineer in a suit, and he brought together worlds. And for her, this is what an engineer does. This is what a visionary does. It not only creates something new, but they become the living embodiment of it. They don't just tell us a new story, they are that story. And soon, they don't even have to open up their mouths. They just walk into the room. Further, she shared about a profile on Elon that she read, and he's quoted as saying something to a friend, and this happened during the time when they were still married. He said something to his friend that he never said to Justine, as well as saying that he was prepared to sacrifice everything, his entire fortune, to get a rocket into orbit. And he said, I don't care if Justine and the kids and I end up living in Justine's parents' basement. I am going to make this happen. And the moment Justine read this, she badly wants to go back in time and ask Elon to take him by the shoulders and look at him very seriously in the eyes and say, have you seen my parents' basement? So, she'd like to wrap up by getting to Elon's advice, which is to always go beyond memorizing formulas, passing tests, to always go deep into the underlying principles of a subject, to track any problem down to the root cause buried in the dirt in the dark. And she would add to that and say, be brave enough, be bold enough, and be insane enough to see things more completely and more vividly, more fully than everybody else around you, and refuse to look away from what you see and what you know, even if the people want to burn you at the stake. And this is because visionaries take all that passion and their badass personalities and their mad skills and mastery of their chosen subject master, and they use it to put themselves on the line, unlike anybody else you'll ever meet. And it is this quality that allows them to open up windows into another deeper reality in which transformation is possible and things of awe happen regularly. Because in the beginning, we don't trust them because we think they're crazy. But by the end, we trust them because we know they're crazy. They're crazy enough to accomplish anything and risk it all to bring us something new to believe in. They might make lousy husbands and terrible wives. They might be the friend who never sends you a birthday present and forgets to show up for coffee, but they bring light to the dark, and they show us the universe. Furthermore, she added that although she was estranged from Elon, she dealt with his assistant when it came to the children, and she does not regret their marriage. Also, she has worked through some anger, both towards Elon for treating her so poorly, and towards herself for believing a fairy tale when she should have known better. Nevertheless, she will always respect his vision and brilliance. Even though their case was split, she can't regret the divorce, since, even though the property issues aren't settled, their marriage is legally over. Meanwhile, Justine and Elon share custody of their children, who are doing well. Now Justine feels grounded and incredibly grateful for her life. So, what are your thoughts on the ending of their romantic relationship? Let us know in the comments below. That's it for this video about Elon Musk's first wife, how she described their relationship. And thank you for watching! If you would like to receive updates on Elon Musk and his companies, make sure you click the subscribe and bell button.